York City. It's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null. Today, since it's Labor Day, and I'm here to share with all of you, it's holiday for a lot of you. I'm live in the studio on our sister station, WBAI, and all the other stations around the United States carrying us live through the Progressive Radio Network. I'd like to welcome you. I'm not going to start with the normal health and nutrition. I'll do that tomorrow, because generally most people are away on holiday. But for those of you who are here, I'm going to share a series of discussions from people who deserve a forum, if for nothing else than to allow us to see what we agree or disagree with their points of view. We're going to be listening to the campaign to silence one of America's leading investigative journalists, Max Blumenthal. It's a short clip. Also, we're going to take a look at the history through the eyes of the historian and senior editor at Eon, and junior fellow at the Harvard Society of Fellows, and faculty, a member at the American University of Beirut and American University of Cairo, Sam Hazelby, about who was first in America. It will surprise you. We're also going to take a look today at individuals who don't always appreciate their own ignorance. And in this case, I believe it's worth doing. There's a person named M.I. Horowitz. He went out to the University of Berkeley. He interviewed a large number of students, including graduate students, about the challenges to the African-American being able to use a cell phone, the internet, having the difficulty of finding identification in order to vote. And putting it into the context of, do you think that this is fair or not? And almost to a person, they considered racist. They then gave their opinions about, unfortunately, as you will hear, what they considered incapable of the basics by the African-American community. Mind you, these are all white liberals at the University of Berkeley. He then flew to New York City, went up into Harlem, and asked the same identical questions to members of the African-American community. I'm sure you could guess the answers. This is just one of the many perplexing things we're faced with today when it comes to identity politics. On Friday, I was asked, would I take a look at a little segment that had been on Tucker Carlson concerning Representative Cortez now equating eating cauliflower as supporting racism. And then he had on this woman named the liberal Sherpa. There is nothing kind that I could say or diplomatic that would describe the level of her inanity, where she's saying that there's a whole lot of vegetables and fruits we shouldn't be eating because it's racist. And what is she using as her guideline for this is just beyond foolish. Now, I won't have time today, but tomorrow I'm going to deconstruct both of those positions, just as I did last week when someone made a statement and was completely wrong in their statements about Palestine, that Palestine didn't exist. It was simply a myth that it's always been Israel. Well, that's not true. And so I took about 15 minutes to describe the real history of the region and how we came to where we are today, where people can rewrite history. Also, the other day, I heard a person talking about how they don't want the Muslims into America because they're going to create Sharia laws, they're going to have their own conclaves, they're not going to assimilate, and then we're going to end up having jihadists here, and that this is something new. And I thought, wow, this person is so disconnected from reality. So today, another history lesson about America and Muslims. So you see, we have a lot to share, but I'm going to start with something different. At no time during the last 2.5 years has the liberal establishment, of which I was for almost my adult life a member till I started seeing the corruption of it and how true liberals don't have anything more to do with the corporate liberal establishment, as many true conservatives have nothing to do with the current politicized Republican and conservative establishment. And they're arguing about Trump. Well, I think most people, outside of his real hardcore small group, which is only about 8%, but how he really got elected. And he got elected, the reality is, because what the Democrats had not done to change the circumstances for the average person's quality of life for a long time. But I don't want to deal in euphemisms and platitudes. I want to deal with just real basics. Let me explain from my perspective why Trump won. And if the Democrats are not careful, why he'll win again. Now, I make no pretense to using this forum as talking about politics, sex, or religion. I don't. And never have. I talk about the politics of science, the corruption of science, the weaponization of civil rights, etc., or civil society, tools such as the police. But what a person does with their vote is their business. I have voted for the independents, Ralph Nader, Rocky Anderson, Jill Stein. And not that I knew we would not, win. We weren't going to win anything. But we would start a seed being planted. And in time, enough people would realize the limitations of the orthodox approach, the two-party system, the duopoly. But let us take a little, and this is just a superficial look at why so many people became independents. More people are independent today than the Republicans and Democrats combined. That's how many dissatisfied people there are. The trouble is when they don't vote, and there's a third party they could vote for, or many other parties they could vote for. Let's start at the beginning. One of Ronald Reagan's foremost policy advisors was a man named Bruce Bartlett. And he once wrote, if Obama were white and a registered Republican, he would be the ultimate neoconservative hero. I would agree with that. Obama made over 500 campaign promises during the 2008 and 2012 runs. I'm going to go through what he promised. It's a matter of public record, and then what he provided. Even allowing that some of the things he promised he would have had to have had bipartisan support, or he could have done by executive order a great deal, or could have had a Franklin Roosevelt fireside chat to explain what the American public needed to know as to why a particular promise was not being carried out. He promises for the average citizen, and that's about at least 300 million of us. He promised tax cuts for 95% of families. It never reached that. He promised that he repealed the Bush tax cuts on the wealthy. That didn't happen. He promised the elderly to create a retirement savings tax credit of low incomes and end income tax for seniors making less than $50,000 a year. Nothing. He, on the economic promises, again, this would impact everyone, mostly the middle class, he promised foreclosure homes would stop. There would be a prevention for all homeowners. He lied. Instead, he gave us the Troubled Asset Relief Program, which called for saving the big banks. Big corporations didn't save a single home. In fact, the Treasury Department's Inspector General called it a colossal failure. He could have called for a moratorium on foreclosures, but he did not. Now, just for a moment, stop and think of that. Because that was at a time when I was traveling the United States, going from town to town, speaking with people who had lived just normal and ethical lives, had contributed to their society, had not stood out for anything negative or toxic in their lives. They were just the salt of the earth people. They didn't ask for much. And when they had some equity built up in their homes, which most did, they then used that equity more often than not for their children or grandchildren's student loans. In other words, whatever the loan wasn't adequate for, or the scholarship, they would make up the difference or co-signed on loans. They also provided some quality of life. And they thought it would continue because it had been going on since 1945. It didn't. You're talking about 7 million homes foreclosed on. At that time, the average size of a home family was 4. It's 28 million Americans. Let's even be conservative and go to 25. 25 million people would be able to fill any city in the United States, any two cities in the United States, Los Angeles and New York. If you took Los Angeles and New York out, you could fill 7 cities. That's how many people were out of their homes. Why didn't they count? The rich? The rich were bailed out. Everyone else was not. He could have. He didn't. What happened to those people? I'll give you one good example. Right close to my animal sanctuary ranch down in Florida is a quiet road. And one Saturday and Sunday, I was driving back and forth to pick up some supplies, and I noticed a lot of cars out in front of each house, like 2, 3, 4 cars. Now, you could expect that with some houses on a Sunday because people come together, friends and family, to share that, you know, afternoon or see a ball game. That wasn't the case. We were not in ball game season. I pulled over and I asked someone, and the guy looked at me and I said, "Look, I'm a neighbor. I'm just curious." He said, "Why? Want to make sure you're not a building inspector." I said, "I'm not." He said, "Well, here's the reality." He said, "These are all single family occupant homes here, and that's what we're permitted to have. But all of us have relatives who've lost their homes. So right here, I'm making my garage into a bedroom and putting up a portable toilet that runs back in and goes down into my septic system. And everyone else is doing the same thing. Now, there are no basements in Florida, you know, the water table's too high. So you can use a garage or a rec room, and that's what people were doing. It's called couch surfing. So people doing the right thing, I mean, what are you going to do? You know, it's your friends or family. You're not going to throw them out. Even if it meant sleeping on a couch. And by the millions, that's exactly what Americans did. So when you saw so few people in shelters, and shelters are dirty, they're crime-ridden, and they're frequently run in a corrupt way, it's no wonder that most people don't want to go into a city shelter. So then they didn't count people sleeping on the streets. Now, if you're not going to go to Riverside Drive in Manhattan and walk down the Riverside walkway, and each night, starting at around 9 o'clock, the people would emerge. They would have hidden their cardboard boxes and their sleeping gear in bushes. And then they would put them all out, and that's where they would sleep no matter what the weather, no matter how inclement. Now, I run very early, so I would run down towards Wall Street, and on my way back, there's a stretch there. There's a children's playground. As a result, there's a bathroom. There's also a water fountain. And you would see them lined up, maybe 50, 60, just waiting, that have their backpacks. And they would take their shirts down and so they could wash their armpits and brush their teeth. And it was all done in silence. I would sit there and watch this. And then they would make their way. They had to be done by 7 o'clock because the police didn't want the people who were the residents of the Upper West Side to see this. It made them feel uncomfortable. Not the fact these people were poor or homeless, or might have even been their neighbors at one time. It just made them, when you're rich, you don't want to be around people who are not. Now, I saw this firsthand, and I spoke with people who lived on the Upper West Side. One person's one of the most powerful people in all of Lincoln Center, and I know him. And he would sit on the bench, and we would have this discussion. And he said, "Yep," he said, "you know, those poor people. But nobody wants them up here, and they know they got to get out. They can come back late at night. I said, well, this is the wealthiest spot on the planet, between 57th Street and Broadway and 125th Street and Broadway, from Riverside Drive to Central Park, is the greatest concentration of successful people in the history of the world. More famous artists and writers and academics and business people. They could afford to be generous. They could afford to be thoughtful and kind. They could afford to put together some projects to help these people. And I don't see them doing a thing. But again, they were never counted in anyone's statistics. I remember when I was told that there was a group of encamped poor ex-veterans over on the other side of Florida. So I took a camera crew and we went over there. And at 10 o'clock in the morning, in the woods we went, and there were 16,000. How in the world do you have 16,000 people in middle of February when it's cold, no water, no toilets? Some didn't even have pup tents, and there's no place to cook, and they would walk 2 to 3 miles to the beach acting like they were, and they had a whole story how they would take a bathing suit and a towel to act like they were going to the beach. And as long as they didn't look like they were vagrants, nobody would stop them. So they would shower there and go to the bathroom there, and then at least they would be ready for the day, because a lot of them practiced good hygiene or the best they could under those circumstances. Then at noon, they would go to the Daily Bread, a place I support and will continue to, because no one else supports it. And they give a good meal, and they also have a shower there and use clothing that they've had cleaned, so that vets are helped. And the guy who owns the Daily Bread in Titusville, Florida, said that it used to be he'd get 50, 60 people, now it's 500. But again, how can you have 16,000 vets in one area and there's no news stories on it? It doesn't exist. And they make it against the law if you're a homeless vet to go to a veteran's, and there are several veterans' parks. They were built for veterans. And today's Veterans Day. So you would think that a vet, someone who has served their country, would have an opportunity to go in and sit in a park and read a book. You do that, if the police ask you for your ID, and if they find that you're homeless, you'll be arrested. And how can a police officer do that? That's something the Gestapo would do. And how often is it done? It's rampant and epidemic, the abuse of homeless by the police. So if you think somehow these people are going to wake up one day and have a conscience and say, this is not right, we shouldn't be doing this, think again. You'll have individuals who will stand up and say, that's wrong and I won't do it. The vast majority will do exactly what they're told, even when it's something that's not significant. So, and I told those people, I will come back and I will help you. And I did. And I did 4 award-winning documentaries on the vets. And now I'm building a village. In fact, it's finished. My veterans' village is finished. I'm just waiting on a sergeant major to oversee it. And it's open for free to the vets to get rehabilitated and get healthy and get trades and skills so they can get back into life. In any case, Obama didn't do a single thing to help a single vet. But he's never criticized. No one ever criticizes the leaders of the paradigm. So all you who could have had your homes helped and not end up homeless or underwater, it was Obama that betrayed you. Look in his face, read his name, and understand that that's why Trump got elected in no small measure. There was plenty of money, unlimited amounts of money. How much? Well, it is estimated at least $21 trillion and was given to bailout Wall Street, General Motors, Chrysler, but not a single U.S. citizen. So it wasn't there wasn't money and there wasn't help. It's just not to you. You don't count. Then he had closed-door negotiations for the creation of the TPP and the TPIP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership. All that was done in private, And the only people invited to be a part of that were the people who benefited from destroying the unions. There was also Obama's opposition to attempts to alter NAFTA to make it more fair. Also, Obama authorized the FBI to infiltrate every Occupy Wall Street movement, campment, and group in America. So when you think that they were just, you know, people wanting to give their concerns as to the greed of American banks and business community, those were considered domestic terrorists to Obama. Freedom of Information documents, as well as WikiLeaks, show that the FBI also even had snipers on buildings. And when I hear someone says, you know, it's never the rank and file, it's only the few at the top at the CIA and the FBI, think of this for a moment. Since when did it become acceptable for a completely, totally, morbidly corrupt FBI, National Security Agency, CIA? There is no such thing as good rank and file, because all of them are working under the same mandate that they have the power, we don't. They will use it at their discretion, even when they break the laws, they do. And they are never held accountable when it's revealed or exposed, not once. You do anything and you're on a list. So when did it become acceptable for the left in particular? I can understand the right. They've always supported fascism in the last 40 years. But for the left that knew the dangers from Operation COINTELPRO and the bombings and the infiltration assassinations, when did it become okay to start to support MS-13? When it became politically expedient? Have you ever seen a photograph of a mutilated person's body from MS-13? Do you know what their initiation rites are? Do you know they're the number one gang coming into the United States and they're not coming to assimilate as good citizens? So Nancy Pelosi then starts to defend them? Do you know what it's like to be a victim? Well, what's it like to be a victim when you are surveyed, when every single thing in your life is considered property of the state, the hidden state, the deep state? Since when do those people, the oppressors, become your friends? When it's politically expedient because you don't like the other people in power? Don't conflate the two issues. I don't like the President of the United States. I don't like anything about him. But it's more than him. He just happens to be the person that's in charge, but the people really making the policy, which he wouldn't have the intellect to do, are the people that are not being named and you should know about. These are the heads of the deep state. That's who they want to protect. So just be clear on it. When the racial mad owls and the other people on these foolish networks, they're not talking about any of the things I'm talking about. It's all politics all the time. And the American public is sick of it. Obama promised a renewal of the entire urban landscape, especially affecting lower-income people. In fact, he said that he was going to go in to all the inner cities and ghettos of America and clean them up. The truth? He only further degraded the poor communities into slums. Read Chris Hedges' books about Camden, Detroit, Baltimore, and Appalachia. You'll see what I'm referring to. On health care, do you remember he promised universal health care? But instead, when those of us, myself included, who know something about health care, we presented very detailed economic and practical ways to achieve it, where you would also not just have universal health care, because in and of itself, that just means people will be seen and treated. What if the model by which you're using to treat someone itself is flawed? Then you're actually giving someone something that could cause them more pain and suffering or even death. So preventative health care was a part of that. Having a national preventative campaign in schools and preschools so that we could help prevent disease. And then also including those therapies that have been listed as legitimate within the Library of Medicine. Not a single person from any legitimate concern about healthcare was invited to give testimony. Instead, every single thing about Obamacare was created by the insurance industry in private. Promise was to cut family insurance premiums by $2,500. It actually increased it by about the same amount. Promise allow imported prescription drugs to save money, prevent drug companies from blocking generic drugs, and allow Medicare to negotiate for cheaper drugs. Never did it. Promise it didn't do it. He promised to reform the Veterans Administration. He didn't do it. He promised education reform affecting millennials and Generation Z. The promise to strengthen our public school system to be competitive with other developed nations. What did he do? The most rapid privatization of schools before Trump. It was their pet project of Ron Emanuel, his chief of staff. Common Core, one of the dumbest, absolutely dumbest corrupt things you could ever teach in school was Common Core. Shame on any teacher who didn't go on strike to prevent your students from dumbing down with standardized testing. And it led to a whole new emergency of school segregation. No money was going to the public schools. It was going for the private schools. He promised infrastructure changes, mostly to impacting everyone in poorer cities. He promised $60 billion bank to fund roadside and bridge roads and bridges and create up to 2 million new direct and indirect jobs and stimulate approximately $35 billion a year in new economic activities. Nothing. Zip. Zero. He failed with women and children. A record on employing women is worse than the Clintons, if you can imagine anything in history being worse than the Clintons when it comes to women. Women suffered a loss of 354,000 jobs during Obama's first term. The number of women dropped from the workforce rose by 4.5 million in his first term. There were failures for low-income families and African Americans and other minorities. Poverty rose by 96% of U.S. House districts. It was affecting all groups, lower middle class, and youth and women. Top ex-White House economists said 94% of all new jobs under Obama were part-time only, later confirmed by Professor Katz and Professor Krueger from Harvard and Princeton, respectively. Jobs for African-American women rose only 2.6% during the first term, compared to Reagan's 15% during his first term. And I'm no fan of Ronald Reagan. Teenage African-American women employment fell 19% during his first term. Child poverty rose 20% to 8 million kids in absolute poverty, abject poverty. Overall poverty rates rose 16%. The median household income declined 8%, equivalent of losing a month's pay each year. Income only rose for top 20%. Militarism, he promised we're going to get out of Afghanistan and train Afghan forces to replace us. The truth, we're still in Afghanistan struggling against the Taliban. Although Taliban forces have increased a couple hundredfold, we're also paying for phantom armies, meaning the Department of Defense sends billions upon billions of dollars to Afghanistan each year, and that money goes to the heads of recruitment agencies and goes to the military. The generals keep it for themselves, and the next paycheck they just keep sending in names made up of people that don't exist, and no one questions it. A New START treaty to reduce nuclear weapons, that's what he promised. Instead, he gave us a $1 trillion new improved nuclear arms race. He promised to drastically reduce and remove U.S. forces in Iraq. Instead, he personally should be held accountable for crimes against humanity, as should Hillary Clinton and everyone associated with the Obama administration, because they worked with the CIA to fund and train ISIS troops along with the other nations, such as Saudi Arabia, in the Middle East. Promise. Close Guantanamo. Well, it's still open today. In our worst economic situation, which was 2008-10, Obama surpassed Bush and Reagan in defense spending with the largest combined budget since World War II. Okay, so you're giving more money during our worst economic times to the military-industrial complex, but what are you doing to save the union jobs in Cleveland, in Detroit, in Camden? How about nothing? But the media loved him, so they were never going to expose the dark side, all of his failed promises. Special operation forces were notably increased, more assassinations, and he got them into more countries. President Obama made sure that we had military on the ground, including special forces and drones in 75 countries on the planet. He contributed significantly to deregulation of arms exports to U.S. weapons market. Some of the largest arms deal to rogue nations such as Israel and Saudi Arabia were under Obama. He ignited a new 21st century Cold War with Russia because of sanctions. He intervened in Paraguay, Honduras, Libya, Egypt, Arab Spring, Ukraine, Syria, and Yemen. All that was under Obama and Clinton. He promised that the federal government would have greater transparency in ethics and information. The reality is, the Obama secrecy, in fact, was the least transparent administration in American history. Obama's Attorney General, Eric Holder, adopted all of Bush's arguments that would discard legal cases against the government and thereby expanding the definition and content of state secrets, warrantless spying, surveillance, and across more agencies. He promised to unite people together, and he didn't. And that's one of the things that gave us Trump. He promised an election funding pledge to preserve public financing of elections. He reneged. He personally raised more private monies than any president in history, calling it grassroots, but it was more corporatized. He promised the reduction and restriction of warrantless wiretapping, yet he signed the U.S. Freedom Act to halt bulk gathering, but has been ineffective due to loopholes in the act, and he knew it. He wove in big IT and tech firms into spying and surveillance program. Facebook, Google, Microsoft, all spy. He promised to create 5 million green jobs. He didn't. He promised to reduce oil consumption by 35% by 2030. The legacy is oil barrels burned daily is increased annually under Obama. He promised to create a cap and trade policy to reduce global warming. Nothing. Nada. Both Hillary and Obama declared the Paris Climate Summit a success. It was a disaster. He expanded hydrofracking. He promoted clean coal. He attempted to initiate a nuclear power renaissance. He was big on pro-nuclear power. He did nothing about Fukushima. He also, in 2006, there was a bill that would permit companies to conceal nuclear leaks from the public. He supported it. He claims the Paris Climate Summit is one of the successes for the nation. Environmentalists and climate scientists call it a disaster. He supported the DARC Act and the promotion of genetically modified foods. He brought more former Monsanto and DuPont officials and lobbyists to his administration than in Bill and Hillary Clinton's administration. He promised to secure our borders. He created, built the actual detention centers for immigrants and returned to native countries, Honduras, where many subsequently were killed, than any other president, including Bush. He increased border patrols by $600 million, and he also prosecuted more whistleblowers and journalists than any president in American history. More people were indicted on treason charges than any other president. More persecution of whistleblowers or would-be whistleblowers than any president. He created the National Defense Authorization Act that targets journalists and free speech. He also was the first president to openly talk about the assassination of U.S. citizens. The president has the authority to decide on terrorism suspects' guilt without any legal process whatsoever. And also, he created the Patriot Act in 2009, Part 2, pushed for the renewal of key Patriot Act provisions and making a law in 2010 after removing the existing language regarding protections of civil liberties. So he gutted the Patriot Act of all civil liberties, all protections. So now, and I have a lot more, but I have other things I want to get to on today's show. Those are just some of the reasons why many people who care about honoring a person's word, when you keep telling people that you're going to make sure that what's in their interest and the community's interest and the state's interest and the environmental interest is going to happen, and it doesn't. When you tell the coal miners and other people in West Virginia that you don't want to see them lose their jobs or develop black lungs, so you're going to invest heavily in renewables there, and you don't. But it was good when you needed their vote. Well, there's a time when you can only fool people that many times, and then they say, enough. So that is some additional reasoning why a lot of people decided they didn't want any more of these lies. We're going to go now to a break and come back, and we're going to go to Yanis, Professor Yanis Varoufakis. I had him on the show once. He was the former Greek finance minister. He is one of the very few finance ministers who's both articulate and tells the truth. And he's talking about how corrupt the European Union is, who controls the European Union, and why they were using Greece in ways that were both, they knew wouldn't work and was extremely abusive. They destroyed the Greek economy, and then they pretended that Greek needed these loans, but none of that money ever reached Greece. And he talks about it. He tells us what went on in closed-door hearings, and I'm not going to play the whole clip. The whole clip you can download on PRN.fm, but enough of it to give an idea of that we were lied to about everything when it came to Greece, and they needed austerity, and they shouldn't own these ports and these railroads and these airplanes and these vineyards. Those should be privatized. No, none of this should have happened. Didn't have to happen. It did happen. And it'll happen again, because 90% of all the European Union countries are deep in debt. Italy, France, Spain, deep in debt. Ireland, deep in debt. They're bankrupt. Absolutely, totally bankrupt. And if it weren't for the fact that the European Central Bank has been giving them up to $80 billion a month, the entire pound would have collapsed and the entire European Union would have dissolved, which would do in any case. Back in a moment, so you can hear someone that you normally, I can promise you, will not hear in any other American media.
New book, Adults in the Room, kind of a tell-all memoir of featuring secret meetings with Larry Summers, people phoning you in the middle of the night, threatening your stepson because you're saying bad things about the bank.
A methane leak, let's say. And the way in which the powers that be, the liberal establishment, which is now protesting Donald Trump and Brexit and Le Pen and so on, massively mishandled the Greek crisis, is indicative of the way in which the liberal establishment has lost the plot internationally after 2008. So the reason why it is in English and why I exerted so much effort in putting it together and not just publishing a Greek book in Greece about our country's problems is because I think that it's a universal story. And it's also a kind of drama, because very often I caught myself in meetings with very powerful people who were caught up in a trap of their own making in a way that only Shakespeare can relate.
The title Adults in the Room, that comes from Christine Lagarde, head of
the IMF. At some point she said that we need adults in the room in order to have an agreement. But it's an expression that she did not invent. It's an expression that, in a sense, relates and reflects the contempt that the establishment has for the people. They refer to themselves as adults. And of course the children are the masses out there, who supposedly are the source of all legitimacy in a properly functioning democracy.
So Sweden hasn't joined the euro. We had a referendum in 2003.
Thankfully, Sweden.
Did we have a lucky escape?
Absolutely.
Why?
Because the euro, the idea of a common currency is splendid. But this particular common currency, the way that it's been designed, it is as if it was designed in order to first create huge capital imbalances, capital flow imbalances, inflate gigantic bubbles, which then burst naturally. And then once you have that, you have depression in parts of the, in the deficit parts of the Eurozone, and deflationary forces creating the circumstances for bigots and xenophobes to rise up in the rest of Europe. This is the architectural flaws is the reason why you should not have been part of it, and we shouldn't have been part of it either.
So in your retelling of this story, the Greek bailouts, it's not about Northern Europe coming to rescue the lazy Greeks who'd been dancing all summer like grasshopper, not thinking about the future, but it's about the Eurozone rescuing French and German banks. How?
Well, look, it's very simple, isn't it? 2008, great financial crisis. All the banks went bankrupt throughout the Western world, every single one of them. In the United States, the elites and the institutions are very pragmatic. They got around the table and immediately pumped up the quantity of public money, of dollars, and effectively deflated the collapsed banks. In Europe, we had created a central bank on condition that it's not allowed to do that. So if your bank, your central bank, cannot reflate the inane and deflated banking sector, and the banking sector is insolvent, the only alternative is to shift quite cynically the losses from the books of the banks onto the taxpayers. So the Greek bailout was nothing more than a bailout for Deutsche Bank, Finance Bank, BNP Paribas, Societe Generale, the French and German banks. Between them, they had lent 200 billion to the Greek state. They were already insolvent because they had stuffed their boots with toxic derivatives from the other side of the Atlantic. And they had already been bailed out by the French and particularly the German government, and Mrs. Merkel could not go back to the Bundestag and demand another wad of money for the same banks that she had just saved. So it was packaged as an act of solidarity towards the lazy Greeks, which of course has to be to come attached with austerity strings, you know, tough love. In reality, this was money that went from the German, Slovak, Portuguese, Irish taxpayer to the Greek state to go straight back to the French and German banks on conditions that guaranteed to shrink the incomes of the Greeks that were not enough to pay for the old debts, let alone for the new ones. A 10-year-old can tell you that this cannot end well.
Because in the book, you're very critical of this, obviously, but you also express understanding for why Dominique Strauss-Kahn, Christine Lagarde, even Mrs. Merkel do this at the first instance.
Understanding is not the same thing as excuse.
No.
Or legitimacy. I believe that whenever you talk to someone, whenever you try to negotiate with someone, you should try to see things from their perspective. It does not mean that you agree with them. It does not mean that you excuse what they do. But that unless you have this capacity to get into the shoes of the other person, then you are not going to have a civilized discussion. My discussions with Christine, with all these people, were very civilized. The trouble was that they did not have the political degrees of freedom to come clean about what they had done, because they had effected a crime against logic, lending the largest amount of money in the history of capitalism, in absolute terms, not relative terms, to the most bankrupt state in Europe, was a crime against logic, especially when they did it under conditions of such harsh austerity that guaranteed the diminution of the incomes from which those loans. Now, of course, they didn't expect to get their money back. But they could not bring themselves
and
to tell.
And they didn't want their money back.
Well, they wanted their money back, but they wanted other things more than the money. They wanted to preserve and maintain their own power structure. In particular, in our case, given that we opposed them, we got elected on a campaign to restructure the debt when they didn't want to restructure the debt. If they had come to an accommodation with us, a compromise, a mutual compromise, find common ground, a mutually advantageous agreement, they would have gotten more money back than they are getting now. But Spanish voters, Irish voters, Portuguese voters, Italian voters, and ultimately French voters might have gotten ideas in their heads that they could have opposed Lagarde, Merkel, Schäuble, Hollande, and so on and so forth, and achieve a better outcome. From the perspective of those who were in power at the time, this was a nightmare, and it had to be snuffed out.
So you mentioned logic. From reading the book, logic seems to be important to you. You are sort of often angry about that people are being irrational in Europe. You can't speak economics at Eurogroup meetings. I mean, you come in as an economist into sort of a very political reality. But
It's a bureaucratic reality.
Okay, bureaucratic. But often when reading this, I was thinking, why is he so surprised?
I wasn't surprised.
No?
I think that my readers are surprised. I wasn't surprised at all. No. I was expecting this fully.
This is over a half hour long. But let me just explain why I think it's important you just hear what he said. He said that they told the world that the lazy Greeks needed to be bailed out because they had about 120% debt to gross domestic product. So the Germans and the French got together and they got other banks and they put together a large package of $200 billion. They then sent it to the central bank in Greece. Then that bank immediately turned around and sent it back to the banks. So the Greek public received none of this bailout. Instead, they were supposed to make austerity cuts. Pensions were cut by as much as 30%. They didn't have large pensions at the time. Some people were able to survive at maybe $1,200, $1,300 a month, but now they had to survive on $700. And for the first time, people were running scarce on food. They actually were engaged in going around to stores to see what food was being thrown out at the end of the day. These were professors, retired, and people who had lived honest, ethical, dignified lives. And so every dollar that was supposed to go to Greece was going to banks. And one of the people, this real cretin, this man who headed the European Central Bank and also the heads of the Strauss. Why? Why would he do this? Simple, because he was going to run for the presidency and did of France. The scandal caught him up and kept him from becoming the president of France. But if he could show that he kept the French solvent and got the money into their banks, that would be a big, big plus for him. You see, this is the story that's not told. So the next time you hear about why there's a need for a great reduction in the cost of persons' wages and pensions, they played this tune before. But listen to the whole interview. One of the things that I hear all the time is that we should be extremely careful of Muslims coming into the country. What if I told you that before there were Protestants and before there were Catholics and before there were anyone else, here there were Muslims that came to America more than a century before Protestants and in great numbers? Why is it we have not heard their history? Why has it been forgotten or intentionally erased? The first words to pass between Europeans and Americans, one-sided and confusing as they may have been, were in the sacred language of Islam. Christopher Columbus had hoped to sail to Asia and had prepared to communicate at its great courts in one of the major languages of Eurasian commerce. So when Columbus's interpreter, a Spanish Jew, spoke to the Taino of Hispaniola, he did so in Arabic. Not just the language of Islam, but the religion itself likely arrived in America in 1492, more than 20 years before Martin Luther nailed his thesis to the door, igniting the Protestant Reformation. Moors, that means African and Arab Muslims, had conquered much of the Iberian Peninsula in 711, establishing a Muslim culture that lasted nearly 800 years. Between early 1492 and the Spanish monarchs, Ferdinand and Isabella completed the Reconquista, defeating the last of the Muslim kingdoms, including Granada. So by the end of the century, the Inquisition, which had begun a century earlier, had coerced between 300,000 to 800,000 Muslims and probably about 70,000 Jews to convert to Christianity. And Spanish Catholics often suspected these Morisco or conversos of practicing Islam or Judaism in secret and the Inquisition pursued and persecuted them. Some almost certainly sailed in Columbus's crew, carrying Islam in their hearts and minds, and by 1503 we know that Muslims themselves from West Africa were in the New World. In that year, Hispaniola's royal governor wrote to Isabella requesting that she curtail their importation. They were, he wrote, a source of scandal to the Indians. They had, he wrote, repeatedly fled their owners. On Christmas morning in 1522, in the New World's first slave rebellion, 20 Hispaniola sugar mill slaves rose and began slaughtering Spaniards. The rebels, the governor noted, were mostly Wolof, a Senegambian people who had been Muslims since the 11th century. Muslims were more likely than other slaves to be literate. They could read, they could write. That was an ability that was rarely looked upon with favor by plantation owners. In the 5 decades following the 1522 slave rebellion on Hispaniola, Spain issued 5 decrees prohibiting the importation of Muslim slaves. Muslims thus arrived in America more than a century before the Virginia Company founded the Jamestown Colony in 1607. Muslims came to America more than a century before the Puritans founded the Massachusetts Bay Colony in 1630. Muslims were living in America not only before Protestants, but before Protestantism even existed. After Catholicism, Islam was the second monotheistic religion in the Americas. The popular misunderstanding, even among educated people, that Islam and Muslims are recent additions to American soil tells us important things about how American history has been written. In particular, it reveals how historians have justified and celebrated the emergence of the modern nation state. One way to valorize the United States of America has been to minimize the heterogeneity in scale in cosmopolitanism, in diversity, and mutual coexistence of peoples in America during the first 300 years of European presence. The writing of American history has also been dominated by Puritan institutions, and it might no longer be quite true, as the historian and Southerner U.B. Phillips complained more than 100 years ago, that Boston had written the history of the United States and largely written it wrong. But when it comes to the history of religion in America, the consequences of the domination of the leading Puritan institutions, for example, in Boston, you have Harvard University. In New Haven, you had Yale University, and they remain formidable. This Puritan effect on seeing and understanding religion is, in early America, brings real distortion, as though we were to turn the political history of 20th century Europe over to the Trotskyites. Think of history as the depth and breadth of human experience, as what actually happened. History makes the world or a place and people what it is, or what they are. In contrast, think of the past as those bits and pieces of history that a society selects in order to sanction itself, to affirm its forms of government, its institutions, and dominant morals. The forgetting of early American Muslims is, then, more than an arcane concern. The consequences bear directly on the matter of political belonging today. Nations are not mausoleums or reliquaries to conserve the dead or innate. They are organic in that just as they are made, they must be consistently remade or they atrophy and die. The virtual Anglo-Protestant monopoly over the history of religion in America has obscured the half a millennia presence of Muslims in America and has made it harder to see clear answers to important questions about who belongs, who's American, and by what criteria, and who gets to decide. So, just a thought, and there are a lot of famous antiquity, Zemuriah, that's Zemourri, was one of the most famous of these, and he did more traveling. He came on a very ill-fated trip, and in fact, he was in the 1542 Cabes de Vaca. He was only one of 4 survivors of the Narvaez expedition, and they published the first European book, later known as The Adventures in the Unknown Interior of America, devoted to North America, and De Vaca told of the disasters that befell the conquistadors of the first 8 years that the survivors spent wandering through North and Mesoamerica. In fact, acknowledged that it was Zemariah who became the indispensable one because he could communicate with the native tribes, and they traveled the entire country from one end to the other. None of our founding fathers have done that before or since. He saw America before any of our founding fathers did, and he was a former Moroccan slave. And what a unique human being. And this is all before 1675 and 1700, the beginnings of the Plantain Society in the Chesapeake allowed the local slave masters to bring more than 6,000 Africans to Virginia and Maryland. This boom in the trade propelled an important change in American life, because in 1668, white servants in the Chesapeake had outnumbered the black slaves by 5-1, and by 1700, the ratio had reversed. But I don't have time to go into any more of this history today. Just once again, trying to correct someone who made a statement without knowing the inaccuracies in the statement. I'm Gary Null. Have a wonderful day today, and remember the real meaning of this. This is a day to honor those who've served their country. And we can disagree upon the merits of the conflicts they've engaged in, and for those small percentage that have engaged inappropriately and have embarrassed America. But let us not forget the brave men and women who have engaged to the best they could, and especially our parents who came back. I remember my father, on the 4th of July, we would stand as a parade went by, and all my uncles and aunts who had served also in the Second World War, and they would just, you could see tears in their eyes. Younger people have no appreciation of what it means to sacrifice your life for greater good. Thank you all for listening, and have a nice day.